How do you conceptualize democracy?
Now, as with the most normative concepts, democracy is, of course, much contested. At the same time, I was very glad that you asked this question, because I think that conceptual clarity, it's lacking in the debates on democratic theory, and I think that without ideas of the concept of democracy, we're not able to fruitfully compare different conceptions of democracy. And I think also the more democracy is applied beyond the state in regional and transnational governance, the more we need conceptual tools to decide whether actually we're talking about increased democracy or what we witness or not witness is something else. So I think also the debate as it presently stands in political theory, we're so eager to come up with institutional designs, institutional solutions to problems of governance that we often forget about conceptual, that we don't really know what we're talking about when we're talking about democracy at the transnational level, for instance. So, okay, if we take a look at democracy as a normative ideal, which is what interests me, it refers to the rule by the people. So it seems indisputable that democracy has to do with equal political power. Perhaps more accurately put, to avoid the complex concept of power, I would prefer to talk about equal political influence or equal distribution of the influence over decision-making. And I think that if we unpack, I mean, basically that would mean that at least all persons who are significantly affected by or subjected to a political decision or law should have such an influence. Now, I consciously left the question open about whether we should decide this by effectiveness or subjectiveness. We can come back to that maybe, but that's a very contested issue in democratic theory. But if we unpack the idea of equal political influence, I claim, and I've claimed in my work, that it accommodates two conditions of fundamental importance. The first is political equality. What distinguishes democracy from other forms of governance, such as monarchy, dictatorship, aristocracy, is that it has components that express and secure some form of political equality. Now, of course, equality plays an important role in democracy in several respects. We have several theorists discussing it in terms of equal respect, equal concern for everyone's interest. But I think what's of interest here in democratic theory is the specific conception of equality, according to which anyone who is significantly affected by or subjected to a political decision or law has an equal right to participate directly or indirectly in the decision-making about it. So that's my first, I would say, my first, what I would call deontological, with scare quotes, dimension of being given an equal possibility of participation. Now, that's a procedural aspect, but I think there's also a more of a teleological aspect of this, is that people can rule over themselves and shape their institutions only if they, at least a sufficient number of them, act politically by exercising this political equality. We can compare rules talking about equal worth of political rights. And I think in my work, I call this condition political bindingness, but that's just my own way of expressing that democracy requires some sort of ongoing practice. Whether that's through informal and or formal processes is dependent a lot on which conception of democracy we favor. What I consider is that political equality and political bindingness is a necessary are necessary conditions for the concept of democracy. So this is my starting point for answering the first kind of level. So what I mean with this bindingness condition is that if we consider a system in which every member had the right to participate but no one ever did, it would be very counterintuitive to call the system democratic. And I think the reason why we rarely give this a thought is perhaps because we always presume that as an empirical fact that enough people do act. So there's something about rule-making, about us ruling over ourselves, that demands at least that some people do something.
Mm-hmm.
So this is my second condition that I would argue for and try to defend. Now, of course, evident there's a broad range of existing democratic models that could satisfy these conditions in numerous ways. I mean, we have scholars emphasizing global democracy as world government bound to global demos through some kind of formal tract. We have, I think, Richard Falk and Tobias Tenchen and Cabrera and others. Other political theories focus on the role of civil society, focusing more on the informal track consisting of civil society engagement, public debate and deliberation and so on. In my own work, I have defended and developed a deliberative conception of democracy drawing on Jürgen Habermas' work. And I find his two-track view very attractive. not only because it stresses the importance of both formal and informal tracks, but because it focuses on the relationship between them. Very, very briefly, these tracks are complementary in this view because informal public discussions can identify social problems that lie outside of the agenda of formal politics and bring them into the decision-making, as well as critical examine rulemakers and require accountability. But the tracks are also interdependent, according to the Habermasian view, since the legally facilitated informal opinion formation in the public sphere and in civil society should be channeled into the legally institutionalized will formation, the outcomes of which are combined with procedures such as majority rule. So that's more the connecting to the formal part. And I think this two-track view is very attractive. I think that the civil society turn that we witness now in deliberative democracy, I'm very skeptical of that when we talk about NGOs and civil society actors trying to be democratic agents. I think that the formal track about having some kind of formalized, legalized procedure is very important. Anyway, that was very, these are really big questions, but this is how I conceptualize democracy, very briefly.
Very convincingly. That's a very, I would say it's a very loaded and very well thought out conception of it. Thank you for that. What, in your view, is democratic contestation and conflict broadly conceived?
Well, I'm not sure exactly how to best understand democratic contestation and democratic conflict. When I think of it, I mean, there are many reasonable readings one can do. Presumably, when we think of conflict, contestation, and democracy, we think of how conflict and contestation are supposed to be accommodated within a democratic system.
Mm-hmm.
But we can further think, we might also have in mind how we can be legitimate enemies within a democratic system. Further, another interpretation would be that we think of how much violence democracy should allow and in what forms. And I think these questions, of course, overlap. But I think the most common way of approaching conflict and democracy in democratic theory is through ideas such as legitimate contestation, contestatory politics, or some kind of rule-based contestation. Since what interests us are not any kind of violence or contestation, but political violence or political conflicts, by which I mean violence and contestation for political reasons. I guess that would be the appropriate way of defining that. Mm-hmm. From this point of view, I think there are two main questions to ask of interest. And what kinds or forms of conflict and contestation are compatible with democratic politics? That's one question. And what kind of democratic politics is possible and desirable in light of deep disagreement? And I think this is where these two questions are different, because we start out, on the one hand, we can start out in conflict and say, how can democracy even be possible in light of deep disagreement and in reconcilable differences? The other is starting with democracy, saying, how much conflict would be legitimate and in what form? So I think these are, broadly speaking, the kinds of questions that deliberative democratic theorists, liberal democratic theorists and agonists have tried to answer in the debate that I'm involved in.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's very central as well. I mean, we see the rise of the Tammuz Ga and Arab, quote-unquote, spring. Were the activities in Tahrir Square, for example, a legitimate route to democratic politics? Or, for that matter, we could compare the storming of the Bastille and so forth.
And I think that what's problematic when we talk about analyzing this so-called Arab Spring from a democratic point of view is that there's one thing to talk about increased democracy, and there's quite another talking about improving or not the prerequisites for democracy, and that's two different things. And I think that people often, what we actually witness is an improvement, perhaps, of the prerequisites of future democracy, is a very different thing. And I think that's most often what we see. Not increased democracy or more democracy in that respect. It depends on who acts on these squares and, you know, if it's some kind of equality involved. That was parenthesis. Anyway.
So if we take one of your questions there, can democracy even exist exist without contestation or conflict? It's something I'd quite like to explore. could there possibly be a form of democracy without this political contestation or conflict in it?
I mean, this is a very popular question, and I think rightfully so. I mean, personally, now I go against many people here, but I find it very odd to see conflict as a necessary condition for politics and democracy, as some people do. Agonist theorists, for instance, and the new realism in political theory. I mean, for me, the concept of democracy can be applied to all kinds of contexts, and we can reasonably call a small group of people democratic if they fulfilled the conditions of political equality and bindingness, as I read them, even if they were not in conflict. On the other hand, I mean, if we by conflict mean any kind of difference over facts or pluralism, then of course it's difficult to see how democracy could do without it. But on the other hand, that question becomes less interesting. I think I would still argue that, nevertheless, I think that we could argue that even disagreement in this broader sense is not a necessary condition for democracy. However, while I don't think there's necessary for democracy conceptually or normatively, it seems to be a very plausible empirical claim to make that any society will be impregnated by conflict over political issues. So this is a very good starting point empirically. And I think at the bottom of this lies differences concerning how we justify democracy. So, I mean, just to reflect on this a bit, I don't see a democracy as a normative ideal that it's primarily handled pluralism or come to fair decision in light of disagreement. This view is common. I mean, it's held by many liberal interest-based approaches. I was thinking of Thomas Cristiano, whose work I like a lot. I mean, he's defending a version of this, starting from the fundamental egalitarian premise that everyone's interests should count equally. He argues that the reason we value democracy, i.e. justify democracy, is that it's the best way to achieve justice under the conditions of disagreement, lack of information, conflict, and so on and so forth. So the reason Cristiano shifts to democratic procedures is thus because he believes that there's no other publicly acceptable way to identify outcomes in which interests have been equally taken into account. Now, so in Cristiano's view, justice must not only be done, but also be seen to be done. Now, I don't find that view very convincing. I mean, in contrast, my more Habermasian critical theoretical view, it's not the public seeing per se that is important, but the intersubjective validation of norms in the public space of reasons. So I have a different starting point, and I think this is why I differ in my view of whether democracy is a necessary aspect of conflict. Because drawing on critical theory, I follow Rainer Forst, the German philosopher, and see equal respect for autonomous agency as the basis for justification. Now, very briefly, Forst argues that there is one claim that underlies all human rights, the claim that human beings must be respected as autonomous agents who have the right not to be subjected to actions or norms that they cannot be properly justified to them. Now, if one has that starting point, the moral basis of the right to justification, I mean, this is not the place to go into detail about this, but when it comes to political context, I think the right to justification is best realized through democracy. In fact, I see democracy as a collective practice of the legitimation of decisions, laws, and so on. And from this point of view, to make a long story short here, democracy is a desirable ideal independent of whether there are conflicts within a demos or not. Because if we're going to abide by a rule, we should be part in justifying the rule. So this is a bit of I have a more dialogical reading of Kant in this respect, but still. So I don't see how we can take seriously equal autonomous agency in a political context expressed as equal political influence if context is essential for democracy, conceptually or normatively. I mean, again, we have a small group of people who never fought and never had conflicts or contestation. Say all of them decided to let one person decide for them, since this person knew exactly their preferences and interests. Why would we desire democracy under such circumstances? I don't see that. So I think political equality is such a basic, it's such a fundamental thing. I mean, I think in order to defend democracy, one must start out from some kind of egalitarian premise, interest-based, agency-based, but not the premise of conflict. So I go against the Champamous and others who, so as a consequence, unsurprisingly, I find it unconvincing to argue, like agonists do, that conflict is constitutive of politics and that consensus is, quote, conceptually impossible, unquote. That's Chantal Mouffe. I mean, Mouffe argues that deliberative democracy is not only flawed but dangerous. To negate the ineradicable character of antagonism aiming at rational consensus, she argues, that's the real threat to democracy, since it doesn't take into account that the aim of politics is always to create a them by determination of an us by determination of a them in a context of conflict. Now, first, the claim that we must create a them in order to create an us, I think, is false, and I think that Arash Abisadeh, I don't know how to pronounce his name, Abisadeh and others have pointed this out. Secondly, I think we have to be careful not to conflate difference with conflict and contestation. To me, difference is a descriptive concept, saying nothing in itself about conflict. Or in Mouffe's words, she talks about antagonism, which concerns difference in a normative sense. And I think that to the extent that antagonism equals difference in a descriptive sense, it's not very interesting for democratic theory. To the extent it's a normative concept, it's flawed, I have argued, because it confuses particularity, which implies difference in general, with individuality, for example, conflict. And I think this to neglect this is to neglect Hegel's insight that individuality requires specific attitudes among the subjects involved. And this is where I go, why I find a broadly Habermasian approach attractive. Because in contrast to, I mean, following Robert Brandom and Sellars, I view autonomy as something as an exercise of agency. So autonomy is not a status that could be distributed. It must be achieved. And this is a social achievement. So to have a social status, and the status as a democratic agent, for that matter, must be a normative status. So to recognize always means to attribute certain normative responsibilities in terms of entitlements and commitments in the space of reason. And here I follow Brandom. And I think that being autonomous, being an agent at all, recognizes recognitive structures. So if we take a look at conflict, I would argue that conflict must rely on some form of consensus to even be acknowledged as such by the subject involved. And here I differ from Mouffe. So there cannot be an ontological, conflict cannot be an ontological feature of politics in my view. That would be my winding up of this question.
You mentioned that consensus is not dependent on conflict, and that difference, that having an opinion is not synonymous with contestation. And I think that I happen to agree. Thomas Seeley, in Honey Bee Democracy, that's his monograph, strange source to bring into it because he's a biologist and he's looking into Apis mellifera, the honeybees. And he was very insistent, though, in the last chapter of his work, that we must refine our forms of, let's say, democratic politics. He argued that we often form opinions that are damaging. And here I link that to your comparison of having an opinion and linking that to individuality and then to conflict. So the individuality's supremacy over the interest of the whole. And Seeley argued that this is damaging to the whole, which can make it very difficult to create any meaningful progress without one side capitulating or agreeing to join the other. Would you agree that at times we must form quorums, or perhaps capitulate is not the right word, but perhaps maybe it's better for us to recognize that it's okay to have a different opinion, and if that opinion is damaging to the greater good, would it be better for us to do away with that opinion and join the whole?
I think now I haven't read this book, so I was not sure first what you meant by refine our forms of conflict, or what he means by that. But I think that, I mean, basically, this goes back to the tension between liberalism and democracy. And I mean, most people today, when they say they're liberals, they think that they're like super hypo-democrat. I don't know what you call it in English, but I mean, there's always been tension between liberalism and democracy, because democracy is about collective decision making, and liberalism has been about individualism, about securing rights. And I think what's interesting now is we see that many democratic theorists, when they look on how to reconceptualize democracy beyond the state, now when we have new context of democratic contestation or potentially democratic contestation, they re-articulate democracy in terms of rights. So we say that, okay, let's say that if we're global democracy in terms of a package of human rights. But I think the mistake one makes is that we can have perfectly implemented human rights without no collective decision making whatsoever. So there's and this is also where the idea of bindingness comes in. If nobody acts, if we have a lot of rights but nobody ever exercises them, we can't have any democratic rulemaking. And I think that what is interesting there with this tension between liberalism and democracy is that, at least in the Western Hemisphere, we know that, I mean, we witness that we're in a time of strong individualization, in which politics is often depicted as getting as much as one needs and wants. And in the latest election, before the election in Sweden, when people were interviewed what they're going to vote on, what party, and it was so fascinating to see how people answered, oh, well, we need this right now because we have small kids and blah, blah, blah. I mean, at least 10 years ago, people would have hidden their preferences and said it would be for the general good. But now it's not even, you know, something, now it's totally fine socially to say that. And I think that the problem here is that no matter how we individualize our societies, democracy is collective decision-making. We cannot conjure away this fact. If we do, I think we fail to take into account the crucial distinction between public and private choices. I mean, even if we presume, for the sake of the argument, that we are totally autonomous, with no false consciousness whatsoever, the choices we made are private, and private choices are not enough to affect public outcomes. So I think we're, as citizens, we're consumers, but we're also democratic agents. And I think democratic governance or government is not just about choosing, it's about public choosing, about dealing with the social consequences of private choices. I mean, if I buy a new car as a private consumer, hopefully, I mean, this doesn't mean that I wish more highway casualties and more dead forests or whatever. I mean, most certainly I don't even think about these things. Only as a public citizen can I reckon the public costs of private decisions. So, I mean, this is what Rousseau meant when he wrote that through participation in the general will, we regulate our private wills. And I think that what democracy, at least as a normative ideal, this is what it should be about. So it's about public choice, and that's not the same as the private choice.
I see a similarity to a discussion that Albert Weil had made in his monograph Democracy in the second edition, where we see this difficulty in sort of looking at aggregates and the placement or identification of homogeneous cores within society. So we could see homogeneity and heterogeneity as public and private, and that tension exists between both. One upholds the other, and the other kind of, you know, brings its, so heterogeneity would, you know, be the use of bringing in new or making pre-existing homogeneous cores better or qualitatively better. If we could prevent the escalation of differences to conflict and then conflict to violence, how would we do that?
I think that if we're going to insist that democracy is the best, if we think that the best way of organizing a political arrangement, I think we have to start out by acknowledging the risk of violence. But on the other hand, this is true of all kinds of societies and political arrangements. This is not something just for democracy. I think we have to... So the interesting question, I think, is what kind of violence an open democratic society can tolerate, and so on, and what kind and penalty for illegitimate violence, through which processes is that supposed to be assessed, and so on. So a healthy society must acknowledge the risk of escalated violence. Now, at the same time, when I was thinking about this question, I was thinking that democracy is far from the best method of stopping violence, right? Democracy is slow, inherently slow and predictable under normal circumstances, whereas violence is often immediate and often unexpected. And I was... In many cases, democracy is perplexed when confronted with violence. And I was thinking of the recent event in Norway, which I bet you read about in the U.S., because it was something different from anything else we have seen, about the massacre I mean, we haven't been close to experiencing anything like that in Scandinavia. I mean, consisting of highly egalitarian, gender egalitarian, fair countries, relatively speaking, and with long democratic traditions. Now we have a crazy man, a Norwegian man, who massacres an enormous amount of innocent people as a protest against democratic, the open democratic society and its pluralistic and multicultural character. Now, on the one hand, democracy could, of course, not stop this sudden, undescribable event. On the other, as Norwegian politicians have stressed time and again since this event, the answer is more democracy and ever more open society. So I guess, while democracy cannot do much about specific violent acts, it can prevent future such events by working for a thickened democratic society. And I think the best way of doing that, to avoid escalation of violence, is to not only, of course, but first to have just institutions, to improve the fairness of institutions, and also the welfare. But I think an equally important task is to strive for an egalitarian society, because differences per se generates violence as well. And then, apart from that, also an active civil society characterized by an open and pluralistic media. This is the best democracy can do in light of violence and in order to prevent violence. And I think that the matter of equality, and now I'm not only talking about political equality, I'm talking about welfare equality and resources, distribution of resources. And I think that there's something inherently good with equality that some liberals miss when they say, you know, that as long as the worst off gets better off. There seems to be something very psychologically important with not having very, very big class differences. Maybe that's maybe my very Scandinavian way of looking at this. But
no, I think it's a humanistic way of looking at things.
Hopefully.
I don't share the prevalent arguments in, let's say, predominantly the USA about capitalism having some kind of difference to socialism. I don't think that's how, let's say, Adam Smith intended it, for example. And I think there are many ways of using capitalism and, let's say, the positive aspects of greed to achieving a better society, a closer society for all. Fantastic. Now, should we analyze a country, let's say Moldova or Belgium, that has a significant and perhaps even consistent conflict or, let's say, political tension between two sides? Would it not be better for those union states to form their own governments and split the country?
I mean, this is not, now we're getting out a bit in the margins of my field. I mean, it might be, it might not be. I mean, secession and separation of government this way is a very complex question. And I think the first thing one has to look at is the reasons why a country is split. Now, maybe not with Belgium, but often there's the case that the split can be traced to questions of justice, or more accurately put, maybe experiences of severe injustice and inequality.
Mm-hmm.
If we take a look at Italy, for example, in which separatists in the north, of course, argue that they want to get rid of the poor south. And I think in such cases, separation could worsen the situation for the quote losing part. But this doesn't seem to be the basic question in Belgium. But I think that it will depend on why the reasons for the separation. That would be my
absolutely. My intention with that question was just to try to transplant the thus far sort of conceptual discussions and try to put them into the practical realm a bit for any practitioners that listen.
Now, I was thinking that involved in this, we're talking about separation of between two sides in politics, if we have consistent conflict. And I think within the domain of political theory, I mean, these questions touch upon the fundamental question and challenge to democratic theory and to democracy, which has to do with the so-called boundary problem that I came to think of. That is, that democracy already presupposes a demos, which is supposed to exercise a kratos. So we rarely think about this, but the demos, we talk about democracy. If we have with students, when we talk about democracy, it's about inclusion. But it's equally about exclusion, which we rarely talk about non-members. And the reason for these exclusions, historically, have rarely been concerned with democracy or justice. I mean, I think the reason, this is a blind spot in democracy theory overall, that when it comes to the very drawing of the boundary, we haven't had any democratic theorizing about it, because, I mean, obviously the nation state saved us from this, and then there was the nation state, and then democracy evolved. But I think that that's just an historical explanation. But now, today, more than ever, when we talk about globalization and when we talk about asymmetries, that we have, I mean, now the social and political space is no longer entirely mapped in terms of territorial places and borders. I mean, what's characteristics now and have been for a very long time is the growth of problems that transgress traditional nation-state boundaries. So here, this is only raises a question that is not new. I think people try to say that, oh, now it's new with globalization, but it's conceptually has been there from the very beginning we entered the word democracy, because there was a demos before the kratos. And I think this, we have to deal with this question if we're going to answer at least normatively satisfying answer to your question about separation, if we have a country, because it's about the justification of the boundaries. And now there are many different proposals for this. I'm just saying that this, I think this is a question one cannot avoid in order to draw near the question about Belgium or any other country, because the boundaries themselves have never been justified, normatively speaking. They've been created by power and violence, mm-hmm. speaking about violence. So I think that's a big, big question for democratic theorists today, is how to integrate the boundary problem and the boundary question within democratic theory. I mean, Habermas has just answered, well, we can't answer that. You know, it's history. History decides. Robert Dahl haven't had anything to say about it either. And so there's an empty space here to be filled
that's
up.
True, that's true. And new theory. I really do applaud you for having emphasized the matter of excluding others and sort of, you know, in order to have, I suppose, different tiers of democratic polities, we have to recognize who is and who isn't within each grouping. It's rather interesting that you brought that up there. I find the boundary issue might also be tied into this question I've been having concerning cartography. Just like yourself, I had gone through with Habermas and sort of came the this look at maps, for example. You know, we always see this when we look at the question of Africa, for example, or South America. Quite often, the people in those countries, in those regions, before European contact, had in many ways their own boundaries established. If we look at the Maya or the Baganda, for example. So, the argument I'm trying to make now is sort of this cartography, this cosmopolitanization of cartography to try to bring democratic legitimacy to it.
That's, I mean, bringing in that question, and it's already there. It's just that we haven't really dealt with it. I mean, it's already inherent in the idea of democracy that we have to think about this. It's connected to, I mean, there are two versions of how to approach this. One is more of an exogenous view, to use Susan Hurley's term, when, you know, you say that, okay, democratic theory should not be concerned with the boundary question because it's logically impossible. You have to presuppose a demos. So we have to have a demos first, and then we can have democratic theory. But on the more endogenous view, which is proposed by many moral philosophers now, and Robert Goodin, and many political philosophers, I mean, is that, no, the boundary question has to be a part of an answer to rule by the people. I mean, to how to best conceptualize democracy. And I think both. I mean, for me, I'm more pragmatic about this. I think that you can do good normative work approaching, but it depends on the problem you want to focus on, I guess. But I think it's an unavoidable decision one has to make in theorizing about these things. And I'm not sure. I mean, democracy must probably. I think some people want to open up and say democracy is like should be bound borderless, and I think that's very scary. I mean, of course democracy excludes, and I think that's good. I mean, democracy, in order to have some kind of egalitarian decision making, we have to have rights. In order to have rights, we have to have legal subjects. So the question is whether it's justified exclusion or not.
Mm-hmm. And at which levels?
That's my opinion.
That's right. We might look at these works on global democracy or post-universalist democracy as an inherently humanistic affair, perhaps at its most the basic form of its theory. But again, once we look at the practice of it, that's when we have to start going and really looking at who is included and excluded. Again, Professor Erman, thank you so very much for this wonderful opportunity to talk to you about your very, very interesting work.
Thank you. This was great.